This is one of sport's great proving grounds, a gateway to glory. Brilliant. 29 tournaments spanning 19 countries. Along the way, a chance to expand horizons and sample life on tour.
How beautiful is that? Magic, eh?
Finish the season in the top 20 on the road to Mallorca rankings and secure a golden ticket to the DP World Tour. This is the Challenge Tour. On the Challenge Tour this time, we find ourselves in Portugal for the prestigious Open de Portugal at Royal Obidos. This beautiful track sits just over 7,000 yards long, and it's a place that can pack a few punches if you don't take care. As we enter the final push in a memorable season, it's now more important than ever for the players to ensure they're sat inside the top 20 on the road to Mallorca rankings to try and secure one of those all-important DP World Tour cards. However, for one special player, after three wins, the dream has already been realised.
Another win for Neergaard Pedersen, this time at the Big Green Egg German Challenge, his third win of the season, and he'll now automatically gain his card for the DP World Tour.
If you asked me before today if I thought I was going to shoot 800, I would have told you, no, you're crazy. You know, I was just hoping to go out and get off to a good start and then, you know, just try to keep it going, really. Oh, I'm so excited. Obviously, I've known for a while that I was going to be playing on the DP World Tour next year, but obviously so happy for it. I mean, see however many events I can get to the end of the year, but it's just going to be enjoying myself.
Yes, win three times on the Challenge Tour in a season and you'll gain automatic promotion to the DP World Tour. Three other players were sat on two Challenge Tour wins each this season. Joel Moscatel, John Parry and Joachim Lagergren, all now looking to follow in the footsteps of Rasmus.
Main goal was definitely to just get back to the main tour as soon as possible. So top 20 in the end of 2024 in the Challenger Order of Merit was the main goal. I feel like during my career, I kind of always had like 2 to 4 weeks in a year where I'm up contending for a win. So I know when I'm playing good, it is good enough to win golf tournaments.
A quite sensational finish from Joachim Lagergren, which meant he couldn't be caught. And he was the winner of the Irish Challenge in 2024.
That might be the happiest I've ever been on a golf course. I mean, to finish off with a whole bunker shot on the 72nd hole to win by one, it's a dream. Amazing. The DP World Tour card was absolutely not done just after a win and a second place there, so I needed a really good finish, or like a top three at least, to get done. Then obviously coming to Sweden with the home fans in the back, it was came in the right time.
With the Lagergren fan club watching, a second title in the space of 3 weeks for Lagergren, one more, and he gets automatic promotion to the DP World Tour.
To be secured for next year on the DP World Tour just means the world to me, because that's where I want to play and that's where I've been for the last decade. So obviously that would be a huge bonus to get straight back there, but I don't really feel any stress with that either. I mean, I'm going to play there next year, that's for sure. And if I get a third win, perfect. If not, I'll get plenty of tournaments in next year.
Well, even though Joachim wasn't in the field for our next event, two others had their eyes on the Portuguese prize. John Parry, sat second in the rankings, knows all too well the importance of a win.
Never really won twice in the season. Maybe as an amateur, but not as a pro. So that was a nice little tick of the box to sort of say I can do that as well, which is always good.
John Parry, winner of the Delhi Challenge. What a finish that is.
I've always been quite good at leading or winning when I've had the chance. But when it's been that long, it's a bit of a, can I still do it? And that was probably the sort of most satisfying thing, was to know that I could still sort of get over the line when it counts.
Harry, with the simplest of putts, to clinch his second win of the season.
That was probably one of the hardest wins I've had, I think. Glad I beat in the playoff. He played really, really good. So it's like hard when you're not quite on your game and he's playing well and he got level with me to sort of get over the line. And that, I think that was one of my sort of favourite wins I've had, really. I wanted to get there before Rasmus or the other guys have won too as well, but that's gone. But yeah, that's definitely, I'm going to play the next sort of three events in a row and hopefully try and get one of them before China. But that is my next sort of aim, definitely.
And another also had automatic promotion in his sights. Spaniard Joel Moscatel had also won twice, with his first success on home soil.
I had my family there, I had my coach there, my best friends were there also playing. And having my first professional win on this season in Spain, in front of the Spanish crowd, my family, my friends, coach, my caddy, who helped me to get the card, was amazing, was really, really special. That momentum kept going. I was playing really good. Then the next tournament was so nice to win. That was a really tough win because I was four shots back at the eighth, and then I won on the playoff. So it was like a roller coaster all day.
And Joel Moscatel picked up his second Challenge Tour victory of the season.
I'm in a great spot, but the pressure is not off because you want to finish as high as you can in order to get in the good tournaments for next year. On this new situation, trying to do my best, accepting all things and finish as high as I can.
Like John and Joachim, Joel would be trying his best to replicate Rasmus and his three wins, but it's safe to say he's glad the Dane is no longer around.
It's just good that he's out now. He has been a pain in the ass. No, just kidding, but he just had a wonderful season and he deserved these three wins for sure. We are in a good position to do it and we have a lot of chances to do it until the end of the season, so why not looking and aiming for that third win.
Well, with the third win in sight, it was crunch time in Portugal. How would the boys fare in round one?
And on the tee from England, John Parry.
On the tee from Spain, Joel Moscatel.
Both poised and ready for a good week, and with eyes on that precious third win, round one was always going to be important. It wasn't the start Joel would have wanted, though. He began with double bogey. And then watched as his playing partner made birdie. Conditions were challenging, with the coastal wind playing havoc with those on later tee times. Both players had their ups and downs, their fair share of missed opportunities, but things would eventually settle. The last, which helped him to a 70. And with three birdies but another drop shot, Joel carded a level par 71.
Just making double on the starting hole is not good, especially being on the fairway, but yeah, I think I had a great attitude and I battled back.
It definitely could have been better, but sort of how it went and how things were going, I'm pretty happy with it. Sort of still around the leaders, if we can have a good one tomorrow.
It was a grind, but I'm happy because I think it was a grind, but at the same time I played really solid. So yeah, just can't wait to play tomorrow.
A new day and a new challenge. The 25 mile per hour winds were playing their part out on the course. Joel struggled on the way in. Drop shots at 14, 16, and a disastrous triple bogey 8 down 18 dropped him the wrong side of the cut line. Parry, however, made a small charge. Four birdies helping to pave the way for a second round 69. Safely into the weekend, though a full 7 shots off the lead. Sadly, it wasn't quite the same story for Joel.
Unlucky on 18, I made a bad decision off the tee and I misjudged the wind on the fourth shot because I lost the first ball, and that cost me a lot, but I tried to battle back one short, I guess, so it's a shame, but it is what it is.
It was tricky today. It felt a little trickier than yesterday. I thought the wind maybe got up a bit more. I think the game's there for a lower score. I just need to hole a few more putts and maybe shoot 4 or 5 tomorrow.
Coming up, Portugal's Thomas Gouveia pays a visit to the medieval town of Óbidos.
It's always nice to show this part of the world to the other guys on tour.
And we'll reveal who comes out on top of the pile in Portugal. We'll see you after the break. Welcome back to the Challenge Tour and to Portugal for the 7th edition of the Open de Portugal. 2 rounds in, and the Frenchman Benjamin Hébert led the way. His Friday 65 had seen him shoot to the top, 2 clear of Scotland's Ryan Lumsden, with 3 others tied third, and Robin Williams having another good week. After this week, just 6 events would be left for the players to achieve their season-long bid to earn a place in the top 20 on the road to Mallorca rankings and promotion. So to moving day on the Portuguese coast, closely followed by Kit Alexander.
Oliver Lindell is 23rd on the road to Mallorca. This was one of 3 birdies he made at the second. A double bogey-bogey finish for a 72. American Matthew O'Shrine has made 5 of 10 cuts this year. He dropped this one for birdie at the 5th, also picking up shots at 3 and 7 to turn in 32. Stefano Mazzoli was cruising at 3 under par for the day. Gave himself another chance at the short 12th. David Booch shot a 69 that contained 1 bogey and 3 birdies, including this one at the 9th. That round got him to 8 under par. Mazzoli converted the birdie putt on 12, trickling it in from the right-hand side to join O'Shrine at the top of the leaderboard. 30-year-old Frenchman Felix Mori was also in the mix. He already had 4 birdies on the day when he played this lovely approach into 16. The putt went in and he finished with a couple of pars for a bogey-free 66. O'Shrine bogeyed the 10th, but he got that shot straight back on 11. He's looking to go back to back with this approach at the very next hole. 6-time Challenge Tour winner Benjamin Hébert recovered from double bogeys at 1 and 2 to shoot a 73. This was one of his 4 birdies on the 12th. O'Shrine converted his attempt and that got him into the lead. He would bogey the 15th and 17th to sign for a 69. That allowed Mazzoli to reach the summit. He made it 3 red numbers in a row on 13, and although he double bogeyed 15, he made a birdie at the last to reach minus 10.
So after 3 rounds, the Italian contender Stefano Mazzoli led the way. Felix Mori, Matt O'Shrine and Robin Williams all sat just 1 shot behind. Hébert's 73 saw him slip back, but note the 2 Finns, Pulkkinen and Lindell, lurking and ready to pounce come Sunday. the Open de Portugal at Royal Obidos lies, perhaps unsurprisingly, in the shadow of the medieval town of Obidos. And who better than a Portuguese player, Thomas Gouveia, to act as guide on our tour?
The origin of the village is medieval, but the houses are from the 1800s. This is a ginja de obidos, a very well-known alcoholic drink that you can drink from a chocolate cup. It's nice. It's always nice and exciting to play on home soil. You get a lot of support and family and friends come out to watch, speak the same language, you stay in a very nice area. Obidos is very nice, so it's always exciting to come up here and play at Royal Obidos. It's always nice to show this part of the world to the other guys on tour. It's different than what where we've been the last couple of months. It's by the sea, a bit windy, but it's great scenery. It's a great place, and I'm sure they will enjoy it.
Yes, a beautiful town. However, sightseeing now had to be set aside. We were at the business end on the golf course. 18 holes standing between our main contenders and the Portuguese silverware. The finale unfolding under the gaze of Kit Alexander.
Matthew O'Shrine was looking nailed on to improve on his best finish of the season of tied 30th. Sights were looking even higher as he played this beautiful approach into the second hole. Sweden's Niklas Lemke was flying through the field with five birdies on the front nine. This pickup on 12 made up for a bogey on 11, and he parred in from there for a 66. O'Shrine tickled this one home at the second. Joined the Italian Mazzoli in the lead at 10 under par. Mazzoli had parred the first six holes, but he regained the solo lead with this putt at the seventh. Oliver Lindell had an even par outward nine. He birdied the 11th. This one pretty nicely downwind at 12. He would find the bottom of the cup. That birdie got him to 8 under par. He rode the par train all the way to the clubhouse for a closing 69. Rotem Yorker number 7, Robin Williams, had 3 birdies and 2 bogeys in his first 15 holes. Gave himself a chance to tie the lead here at 60. That's exactly what it is, as a birdie putt took him into a three-way tie at 11 under par alongside O'Shrine and Mazzoli. The Italian churned out the pars until this struggle on 17. Dropped shot, and he was now one back with one to play. Unfortunately for Williams, he visited the water twice on the 18th as he racked up a costly triple bogey to slip to 8 under par. But it was still another good week that takes him a step closer to promotion to the DP World Tour. Mazzoli could only par the par 5 finishing hole, and that meant Matt O'Shrine had the simplest of tap-ins for his 5 to turn his struggling season around with a brilliant Maiden Challenge Tour title. A career-changing win for the American, and he bathed in the glory and the beer.
Yes. guess the drinks quite literally on Matto's shrine, holding his nerve to edge out Stefano Mazzoli and make his big breakthrough. There were good showings from some familiar names, the likes of Hermes Hayes and the Finnish pairing Pulkkinen and Lindell, as well as Robin Williams, all prominent, and John Parry enjoyed another good week too. But the plaudits, in the end, went to a delighted American.
It's great. You know, I feel like I've been playing some good golf. Have had a few opportunities, started to get on my number. This is week 9 in a row for me. So keeping the energy up and just giving myself a chance going into this weekend was important because I knew I needed a win or a second really to do what I needed in the season. So to get it done feels great. It has not fully set in. It was my birthday yesterday, so it was a good birthday present to myself this week. Need to book some travel now, and I'm excited. It's been great. Chasing the main tour cards, obviously a bit more of a possibility now with getting all the points I got today. I'll take a look tonight. I'm gonna enjoy today first for sure, and that'll figure itself out. They're good problems to have, excited to solve them.
Well, let's see how all of that affected the road to Mallorca rankings. Rasmus Nygaard Petersen, already promoted, of course, and still out on top. John Parry strengthened his position with Robin Williams and Dion Hermisays, upwardly mobile members of the top 10. Further down, Benjamin Hébert is up to 11th. Tapio Pulkkinen's impressive week in Portugal saw him rise 4 places into 15th. And his Finnish compatriot, Oliver Lindell, now lies in 20th, a position that will become critical come the season's end. And sadly, with that, we have to wave goodbye to Portugal for another season. Next week, with the finishing line growing ever closer, we're heading to Italy, where ancient meets modern, as the class of 2024 bid to take their own small place in Challenge Tour history, and the pursuit of promotion to the DP World Tour continues.